The Apostle John was on the island of Patmos. He was in prison for the testimony of Jesus Christ. And he heard a sound behind him, and he said, I looked. There was a door standing open in heaven, and I heard a voice which was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you the things that must take place. That's what we need, my friends, the heavenly perspective of the things that are going on in the world around us, the things that the Word of God foretold us would come to pass, those things which must take place, those things which are taking place even now. That is what this broadcast is all about, discussing the issues of the day, discerning the times in which we live from a biblical perspective and worldview. Good afternoon, everybody. Andy White here, and what you are about to hear is, of course, the fusion of heart, mind, and soul. And I want to welcome everybody from all across the fruited plain and all around the spherical globe. Yes, it's a sphere. It's a globe. For all of you flat earthers out there, I know I just want to make your mind go on tilt. But it's a spherical globe. Anyway, I digress. Thanks for tuning in, everybody, to this week's edition of Open Up the Doors. I am streaming live on my Open Up the Doors Facebook page. If you'd like to join in over there, let me know where you are watching from. And please share this into your streams. Share this into your Twitter stream. Share this into your YouTube stream. Share this into your Facebook streams. Invite people to Open Up the Doors over at facebook.com/faithfm91.7. If you never liked my page, please like the page. Become part of the listening family here at Open Up the Doors. Again, for those of you who are on Facebook, let me know where you are listening from, where you're watching from. If you'd like to interact with me privately, you can email me at ajwhite777@icloud.com. It's ajwhite777@icloud.com. We are streaming live over the internet here from Faith FM at hamptonschristian.com over the internet. If you happen to be sitting in your office and you want to see the Facebook stream, or you want to hear the simulsync off of the broadcast streaming, go on over to hamptonschristian.com. If you are outside of the Faith FM broadcast area, the best way to listen to Faith FM Christian programming from the east end of Long Island 24/7 is to download our free apps. We have the Faith FM app for free. We have it for the Apple platform, which you can get over there at the Apple store. And we also have it for the Google platform. What's at the Android? Get that over at Google Play, the Faith FM app. It's a great way to listen to Faith FM if you're outside of the broadcast area here on the east end of Long Island. All right, I think I got my preliminaries all packaged up and set up and put away. I want to just take a glance over at my Facebook stream, see who's there. Guys, thanks for tuning in, joining in there on Facebook. I'll try and keep a watch on my comments. You know, if you want to shoot me any questions during the course of the broadcast, please do so, and I will try and, you know, answer any questions you might have or any comments that you might want to share over the broadcast. Hi, Gene from Wisconsin. Thanks for joining in. Diane Evanson, God bless you, Diane. Thanks for tuning in. Debbie, God bless you all, as always, of course. Well, let me get on with the broadcast here today, because, of course, needless to say, I've got way more on my plate than I have time to get into. I just see somebody coming up on Facebook there, Connie from Louisiana. Hey, Connie, God bless you. Thanks for joining in here on Open Up the Doors. Well, I have some serious questions to raise today. I have some serious questions, and I have a serious challenge to bring to you today, to all of us, myself included. But the challenge that I want to bring to you today is it's wrapped up within the question that I want to ask, which is this. Where are the people of courage? Where are our leaders? America is on the precipice of the abyss. The whole world is rushing towards judgment. And our nation is suffering, my friends, from a real dearth of courageous leadership. From the government to the pulpit, courage is lacking, and leadership is nowhere to be found. From the phony politicians to the false prophets, truth has fallen in the streets. Falsehoods and lies are exalted and embraced as enlightenment, while the truth is suppressed in unrighteousness. And I ask the question, where are our leaders? Our national leaders have all collectively gone mad. Oh, they might. Of course, there's one or two. I'm speaking in generalities. There are a few. There's always a remnant. There's one or two there. But for the most part, our national leaders have gone mad. They are cowards. We have a lot of cowards in the pulpits these days, too, I might add. We're a nation dealing with the criminally crazy and the cowardly compliant. And I was beginning to feel like, am I the only one that's seeing this? Am I the only one that's feeling this way? Is it me? But this past week, it's funny, I've seen several different articles this past week on this very topic. There was a really good column this week by conservative blogger Daniel Horowitz. And he wrote in his article, quote, as Americans face the worst anarchy of our lifetimes, growing crime, drugs, and an unraveling of the culture, most voters care about their neighborhoods more than any other geopolitical issue. They want safe and secure neighborhoods. They want a return to normalcy. Republicans could crush Democrats on the issue of rioting and crime, even with Trump struggling with his image on some other issues. But instead, the Republicans, they have chosen to drag race Democrats to the gates of anarchy in promoting every premise of the BLM agenda. And rather than pushing a united front on law and order, Republicans are tripping over themselves to pander to the mob. And I say to Daniel Horowitz, long article, but that was amen and amen, Daniel. Looking at all the videos and the pictures and the reports and the images that are coming in from all across America, Horowitz exclaimed in this article he wrote, he says, he asked this question, is this America or is this Baghdad? Hello. Funny he would say Baghdad, I was thinking as I read his article. Baghdad is Iraq. It's ancient Babylon, of course. I want to pick up on something and elaborate some more on something that I touched upon in last week's broadcast out of Daniel 3. And I want to ask, where are the Shadrachs, Meshachs, and Abednegoes who will not bow down to the lies, who will not appease the mob, nor comply with their demands by paying homage to the idol of a false narrative? You know the story there in Daniel chapter 3, verse 1? And again, like I said last week, I can't read the whole chapter, but I will encapsulate it for the sake of time. In Daniel chapter 3, we read that Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold, whose height was 60 cubits and its width 6 cubits. Again, I want to reiterate, it's a type and figure of the Antichrist, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. 60 and 6. It's a figure and a foreshadowing. And in Daniel 3:4, we see where the herald cried out in regards to this giant image. 60 cubits, by the way, is 90 feet high. And the command went out. To you it is commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that at the time you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, and the harp, and the lyre, and the psaltery, in symphony with all kinds of music, you shall fall down and worship the gold image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. Whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Whoever does not fall down and comply with our demands will be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. It's funny, just the other night, a leader with BLM in an interview at Martha McCallum said, if America doesn't meet our demands and doesn't meet our wishes, we will burn the system down. Yes, fall down and bow down to us, or you will be cast into a fiery furnace. But getting back to Daniel, because word got back to Nebuchadnezzar. As everyone's bowing down, as everyone's complying with the mob and the rule and the zeitgeists, word gets back to Nebuchadnezzar that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego wouldn't get with the program. What is it with these guys? Yo, dude, you got to bow down. You've got to comply. You've got... When Nebuchadnezzar heard this, he wasn't happy. So he calls them. And he says, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Is it true that you do not serve my gods, nor worship the gold image which I have set up? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered, said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. Because if that is the case, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, hey, my faith's in God, and I'm a servant of God, and he's able to deliver me. But if he doesn't, nevertheless, let it be known, O king, that we will not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. The Nebuchadnezzar was filled with fury, and the expression on his face changed toward Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And he spoke and commanded that they heat the furnace 7 times more than it was usually heated. Yes, I see a little picture of the tribulation here. A time of unprecedented pressure, a time of unprecedented heating up of the furnace of trial and tribulation. And they were thrown into the fiery furnace. You know the story. You know the story in Daniel chapter 3. But I want to ask the question. I want to appropriate, if I could use that word, the imagery of their courage, of their fidelity, and their faithfulness to the true God, to the living God, to the truth. And I want to ask the question, where are the Shadrachs, Meshachs, and Abednegos of today? Where are the brave? Where are the bold? Where are the courageous? Where are those who will stand up for truth even when everyone else around them is bowing down to the lie? Courage with a capital C. That's what we need today. Where are the Davids who will stand up and rebuke the spirit of fear that paralyzes the people of God? God's people, God's leaders, smitten with fear. And don't tell me that isn't true. I see it all around me every single day in so many different ways. And others are seeing it too. Others like Mario Murillo, who just put out an article the other day on this very topic. And I want to tell you something, folks. I had this broadcast ready to go from last week about what I wanted to share this week. And I started seeing all of these articles and columns written by both secular, Daniel Horowitz is a secular writer. He's Jewish, I believe. I'm sure he is. Mario Murillo, from the secular to the sacred, from the secular to the prophetic voice. People are seeing what I'm seeing. It's not just me, though. Sometimes I feel like it's just me. But Mario Murillo just made this statement the other day in an article that he had titled, The Feeble Response of Christian Leaders. And Mario wrote in his article, it is just about the most disheartening thing I can think of. An army ready to fight, being held back by a reluctant general. Yet that is precisely what we are watching happen to millions of American Christians. We are ready, but our leaders are not. Where are they? So many believers just can't fathom why celebrity pastors, that's probably one of the problems, they're celebrities. They don't want to rock the boat. They don't want to, they love their celebrity status. They don't want to delve into the realm of what might be controversial, Mario. But Mario writes, so many believers just can't fathom why celebrity pastors are not pushing back against the destruction of the United States. I feel your anguish, Mario. The armies of God are trembling in silence as Goliath is taunting. Where are the Davids who will stand up and boldly declare, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? In other words, David was basically saying, who do these sons of the devil think they are? And that's my question. Who do these sons of the devil think they are? That's what David's heart was like. He wasn't going to let the godless heathen, not even a giant one, think that they could defy God with impunity. Where are the Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednegoes? Where are the Davids? Where are the Elijahs of God who will stand up to the Ahabs, the evil rulers, and say, it is not I who am a troubler of Israel, but it is you who troubles Israel. You know the story in 1 Kings 18. You know the story that Jezebel had been massacring the prophets and Ahab had been hunting for Elijah. There was a price on Elijah's head. And we read in 1 Kings 18:1, and it came to pass after many days that the word of the Lord came to Elijah saying, go present yourself to Ahab. Wait a minute, God. Don't you know I got a price on my head? Don't you know he's got a wanted poster in every post office in Jerusalem and every post office in Israel? Don't you know, Lord, that Ahab's been looking for me, and now you're telling me to go present myself to Ahab? That's not in the Bible, and I don't even know that Elijah thought any of that. I think lots of us probably think he could have, because he was a man of like passions, the Bible tells us, as we. So Elijah did what God commanded him to do. Then it happened when Ahab saw Elijah that Ahab said to him, is that you, O troubler of Israel? And Elijah answered, I have not troubled Israel, but you and your father's house have, in that you have forsaken the commandments of the Lord and have followed after the Baals. And that is where America is today. We have forsaken the commandments of the Lord, and we have following after the Baals. And it's plural. There is many of them. So I keep asking the question. Where are the Shadrach, Meshachs, and Abednegoes? Where are the Davids? Where are the Elijahs? Where are the Ruths who will stand up before the rulers of this dark age in righteousness and speak out against an evil plot, who will present themselves to the ruling authorities, knowing that they were born for such a time as this, with the attitude of saying, I have to stand up for my people. I have to stand up for the truth. I have to stand up for righteousness. And if I perish, I perish. Come what may. Where are the remnant? Where are the remnant? The 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Where are you? I want to know where you are, because my heart is with you. I believe there is a remnant of believers who are starving for a real, courageous, and biblical leadership. I believe there's a remnant who are looking for the Davids and for the Elijahs, for the Gideons and the Joshuas. I know God's got them out there. Maybe they're hiding in caves right now. going back to that story in Kings, Ahab had a servant named Obadiah. Wasn't Obadiah the prophet? Similar name, same name, different guy. But this guy, Obadiah, when Jezebel had been slaying the prophets of God, Obadiah had hid them away in 50s in caves. I know there's a remnant of courageous men and women of God out there. I know there's a remnant of 7,000 out there who have not bowed their knee to Baal. But it's time to rise up. It's time to come out of the cave. It's time to go and present ourselves and say, it is not us who are the troublers of Israel. It is not us that's wrong with America. It's not the Christian church. It's not the Judeo foundation of the church that's wrong with America. It's not what God created in righteousness that's wrong with America, that troubles America. It is you. And we're going to stand up against you. And we're going to slay every lie with biblical truth in the name of Jesus. Stick around. I'll be right back. Here's an old classic tune by Michael Card, Dragon Slayer. I listened to this tune last night for the first time in a long time. And I said, I got to play this today. Because, folks, we got the sword of truth in our hands. And God's telling us to go out and slay some dragons.
Who might this newborn dragon slayer be?
Behold the dragon slayer. Michael Card. Welcome back, everybody. Andy White here. You are listening to Open Up the Doors here on Faith FM, WEGB 90.7, 93.3 in Appeague, and WEGQ 91.7 in Quag. And I am here penetrating the unseen powers of darkness by simply speaking the light of truth, sending powers and principalities into frothy fits of frenzies. Yes, I am. Praise God. Well, if you are just joining in, I am streaming live on my Facebook page. Please go on over to facebook.com/faithfm91.7. Join the conversation over there. Let me know where you are listening from, and please share this into your streams. I've been inquiring today, and I've been putting a challenge out today about where are the men of courage? Where is our leadership? There's such a dearth of leadership in America today and in the church today. Where are the Gideons, the mighty men of valor? You know, I've said it many times over these past years I've been on this broadcast. If I've said it once, I've said it 100 times. When you compromise with evil, evil will always win. And compromising with evil is bad. It's very bad. Cowering before it is even worse. America was once governed by the rule of law. Now it's being handed over to mob rule. You know, once, brothers and sisters, hear me out. Once the mob believes it has power, it will become more and more violent, and it will get more and more bloody. And this mob is realizing it's been given power. This mob is beginning to understand that they've been given power. And the reason the mob believes it has gotten this newfound power is because of the failed leadership of cowards. And that's what they are. I'm going to call them out today, both in the public sphere, in the political realm, and in many of our pulpits. I'll say it again. I'm really serious about this. This has been eating at me for months now, from the coronavirus thing to this new thing. The fear that I see, especially in God's people. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind, as the children of God. But now that this mob has believed it's gotten power, and the reason it has gotten this power is because moral cowards have refused to call evil evil, and they're bowing down to the false narrative of an idol. Moral cowards who will appease evil because they'd rather be stroked for being woke. In the meantime, the carnage on America's big city streets. Did you see the reports last weekend? Father's Day weekend. The carnage in Chicago was off the charts. In Chicago last weekend, 104 people were shot. 14 people, including 5 children, one as young as 3 years old, were killed. The vast majority of the victims were black, and the vast majority of the shooters were black. But there'll be no protests calling attention to the plight of any of these victims. We probably don't even know their names, except for their families who are in mourning and grief-stricken. On Father's Day, instead of celebrating fathers, what happened in Chicago last weekend was in large measure the result of years of fatherlessness. Do black lives matter in Chicago? Because you never hear BLM or Antifa or any of these radical groups ever really talk about it at all. Meanwhile, the progressive left, which claims it wants to bring us all together, false claim. They spent the weekend tearing down more American memorials and statues, even of abolitionists, tearing down statues of people that freed slaves, that helped slaves. It's gotten past anything having to do with race. It never had anything to do with race from the get-go. It was just a convenient excuse for these anarchists and for these Marxists. And it's still amazing how many people refuse to accept the obvious. New York City, last week, 2 weeks ago, disbanded its undercover crime unit. Crime and shootings are up 400% since they did that. Last week in New York City was the first week without that undercover crime unit patrolling the city. And over the weekend, 19 people were shot and one was killed. In the apple of the left's eye in Seattle, the Seattle Utopia, known as Chaz/Chop, depending on who you talk to, 3 people were shot last week and one was killed. And when police arrived to provide assistance, they were pelted with bricks and bottles. You may recall from these cowardly people, they're supposed to be our leaders, but they're not. The mayor of Seattle had called Chaz the site of a summer of love. Well, that summer of love is fading quickly into a summer of chaos. Well, that's really what it was from the get-go to begin with. These people, they chant. Their mantra is no justice, no peace. But they know neither. They don't know what justice is because the Bible says the wicked do not understand justice. They don't know. They do not understand nor know what justice is, and they don't know what peace is. Yet they chant, no justice, no peace. But they will have neither, and they will achieve neither, unless they repent. For there is no peace for the wicked, says our God. I want to ask another question today. Like I said, it was going to be a broadcast of questions and challenges. Are you a peacekeeper or a peacemaker? There is a difference between the two. Peacekeeping generally works through appeasement. It's the way of the coward. Peacemaking works through the strength of core values and moral conviction. It's the way of the courageous. You need to understand something, that peace is not necessarily the absence of conflict. It would be nice not to have any conflict, but in this world you will have conflict. In this world you will have tribulation. Peace isn't necessarily the absence of conflict. You can be completely at peace in the midst of a chaotic situation when you know the Lord Jesus Christ. Peace oftentimes is simply really the proper management of conflict, the righteous management of conflict. Paul writes in Romans 12:18, if it is possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. You see, peace begins with you as much as it is possible. Conflict resolution. It requires honest dialogue. It requires a willingness to listen. It requires a humility to yield when and where yielding is appropriate. Conflict resolution, peace making as opposed to peacekeeping, requires a willingness to forgive, a desire to be reconciled. Nothing that you see happening in the streets, my friends, with these mobs. There is no willingness there for forgiveness. There is no reconciliation desired. It's all about simply tearing down the system, burning it down. Peacemaking will include justice and righteousness and strength. Peace through strength is a right axiom, is a correct axiom. Peace through strength, binding up the strong man. Jesus said in Luke, when a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are in peace. Peace through strength. But when a stronger than he comes upon him and overcomes him, he takes from all his armor in which he trusted and divides the spoils. The stronger you are, the more peace you will have. Ronald Reagan had it right. Yes, as Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Peacemakers are strong. Peacemakers are courageous. Peacekeepers. Let me rephrase that. Peacemakers are strong and courageous. Peacekeepers are feckless, cowardly, and weak. And there is a war between the sons of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. But there is a war between the sons of God and the sons of Belial, the sons of the devil. So I ask the question, where are the men and the women and the Christians of courage who will stand up against those, who will stand up against the sons of Belial, who will say, no, we're not going to appease your wickedness. No justice, no peace. Really? The sons of Belial, I'll say it again, are not interested in peacemaking. What they want is capitulation to their demands. And it is the cowards who do not understand the difference between peacekeeping and peacemaking, who hope to pacify them by means of appeasement. And appeasement never works, my friends. Appeasement never works in keeping the peace. It just delays the inevitable. It just delays the war. Appeasement just paves the way for further demands by the aggressors. Peacekeepers seek to keep peace through the easiest means possible, which is generally simply appeasement. Whereas peacemakers work towards a lasting reconciliation, and that takes hard work. That takes hard work. Be at peace with all men as much as it depends on you. Sometimes your efforts may not be successful, but at least you will always have the knowledge that you tried, and at least you will not have a false security of a false peace, and you'll be prepared to deal with the real issues in a realistic fashion, which we're not seeing in what's going on in America today. I want to say this before I go to my break. Never confuse peacekeeping and peacemaking. Peacekeepers are generally cowards. Peacemakers are strong and bold and brave and courageous. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Folks, stick around. I'll be right back. Here's Casting
Crowns.
We were
made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way.
Absolute truth.
We could be the generation that finally breaks the chains.
The fusion of heart, mind, and soul. This is Open Up the Doors with Andy White here on Faith FM, WEGB 90.7, 93.3 in Epeague, WEGQ 91.7 in Quad. Thanks for joining in, everybody, to this week's edition of Open Up the Doors. I am streaming live over my Facebook page. If you're just joining in, go on over to facebook.com/faithfm91.7 and join in the conversation over there. Let me know where you are listening from. And we've got listeners from all across the Fruited Plain, from Wisconsin and from Ohio and from, of course, the east end of Long Island here and maybe some other place. Oh, Louisiana was joining us a while back. So please let us know where you are joining in from, and please share this into your streams as well. I do want to mention that I also have a YouTube channel, and I would ask, please, I beseech thee, brethren, by the mercies of God, if you have not subscribed to my YouTube channel, please subscribe to the channel. We really need to get the subscriptions way up there. There are things that I can't do on Facebook. YouTube, unless I have a certain amount of subscribers. They just limit things over there. And I'm nowhere near, unfortunately right now, I'm nowhere near where I need to be with YouTube subscriptions. So please, if you have not subscribed, it's real easy. Just go over there to Andy White, Open Up the Doors. You'll see the subscribe button. Hit that subscribe button and also hit the little bell next to it. That bell will let you know when we upload these broadcasts. All these broadcasts get archived and put into the library section there, the video section there on YouTube. So you can come back. If you missed the broadcast, you come back and look at it. They are edited down. We have to do that. We have to take the music portions out of the YouTube productions because of all kinds of copyright laws and different things and all kinds of licensing and different things, and it becomes kind of a hassle. But it also just gives you the meat and potatoes of the broadcast. There's also other things on the YouTube channel as well, not only the broadcast, but other videos that our video producer produces and makes, you know, different things in the like section, videos I've liked from other people that I think are of value that you might also find to be a useful resource. So again, please go on over to my YouTube channel and subscribe there. It would be really, really appreciated. All right, where am I at in everything else here? Is there anything else I need to address? Let me look over at some of the comments on the Facebook stream. Anybody got any comments for me you'd like me to share? Any questions? I will be happy to address them. I see people from New Jersey watching. Thank you for joining in. Thanks, Brother Joe. Thanks, Jimmy. Thanks. All right, I don't see any questions right now, so I'll just go on with what I have here. But I would like to address any questions that you might have as well. Or any comments, anything I've said that you would like for me to maybe elaborate more on. All right, anyway, if you're just joining us, before we went to the break, I played a tune by Casting Crowns called You Were Made to Be Courageous. And one of the lines in that tune is, where are you, men of courage? That's how I opened up this broadcast today. Where are the people of courage? We were made to be courageous. It's a nice tune. It's a great tune. But biblically, it's more than a tune. We need to be last days people filled with boldness and bravery and courage. And I have to say, sadly, I see such a lack of it. We need to get on our faces before God. All of us, myself included. I'm not a superhero. I don't claim to be a superhero. I'm just as much a wuss as anybody else is. But zeal for my Father's house has consumed me. like that day that Jesus was just so filled with indignation at what was going on in the temple courts, and he made that whip to drive those people out. And it was because it was written of him, zeal for my Father's house has consumed me. And when zeal for your Father's house has consumed you, you'll step out and do things maybe that seem like a little bit out of character maybe. But there's a difference between the anger in the mobs that we see on the streets and a righteous indignation. The Bible says to be angry and sin not. But I digress a little bit. But a few months back, and I want to get to this before I do run out of time. A few months back, I did a broadcast. I think, I don't remember when it was. You could find it on my YouTube channel. I think it was back around October, November of last year. But I did a broadcast that I titled, Take Heed, It's Coming. I talked about persecution coming to America. And one of the things I said in that broadcast, I want to repeat right now. In that broadcast, I said this, the true believers, church buildings will be burnt down, attacked, and ransacked. The only ones that will be left alone will be those flying rainbow flags. Well, at least until the Islamists come around anyway. The apostate churches that have rejected the word of God and have embraced moral relativism, they are being accepted by the world as enlightened Christianity. You know, the ones who are locking arms with the BLM rioters, the ones who are locking arms because they want to present their false sense, their virtue signaling, and try to disregard what the organization actually is. But we've been standing up. Many of us have been standing up and saying, no, 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 no. This organization, they use a slogan like Black Lives Matter to bait you in, to rein you in, to reel you in because of a true sentiment, because of a true statement. But that's not what they're about. But true Christians are being called evil, and apostate Christians are being called good. The coming persecution that's going to be released upon the remnant believers of Jesus Christ, it won't come from just a jihadists. It's going to come also from an apostate church. It's also going to come from those who think they're serving God, as Jesus said. It's going to come from the progressive political and media allies. Buckle up, it's coming. My friends, it's here. This past week, BLM activist, I'm sure some of you saw this already, but BLM activist Sean King tweeted out this past week. Sean King said this, yes, I think the statues of the white European they claim is Jesus should also come down. Sean King is inciting the BLM movement to tear down the statues of Jesus, to tear down the statues of Mary, to tear down the white European. Now hold it right there, because I've seen some of the comments from some of the Christians who were saying, rightfully so, that as Christians we shouldn't have statues anyway. And that is definitely true. But you miss the point. Because what's motivating them to do this is not a righteous indignation against idolatry. What's motivating them to do this is their hatred of America, is their hatred of the Judeo-Christian Foundation, and that is the issue. So could we please get off the idea that, oh, we Christians shouldn't be worried about statues? Because that's not the point. The point is their motivations. The point is the intention and the reason that they are doing what they're doing. And anyway, Sean King went on to say, tear down these white Jesuses because they are a form of white supremacy. I have never seen anything in the Bible about Jesus being a white supremacist. I'm sorry. But according to Sean King, he says that these Jesus statues are a form of white supremacy. They always have been. And then he makes a really lame and stupid and idiotic statement. And Sean King, if you ever hear this, yes, I'm calling you out because you are an apostate. You are an apostate that needs to repent. I bet you a lot of people here don't know that Sean King was a pastor. Sean King actually founded a church back around the mid-2000s and pastored it for a season. Did you know that about Sean King? You want to know what the name of his church was? Irony of Ironies. The name of Sean King's church, he no longer pastored. He left the ministry because he felt disillusioned with the ministry. Well, I'm sure he probably did because he was pawning off a progressive socialist gospel and not the real gospel. But Sean King's church was called Courageous, of all the ironies of the day. Anyway, Sean King calling for the murals of Jesus and the stained glass windows of the white Jesus to be broken and taken down. And he said this idiotic statement. In the Bible, when the family of Jesus wanted to hide and blend in, guess where they went? They went to Egypt, not Denmark. Tear them down, those white statues and white pictures of Mary. Now, number one, Sean. Number one. They went to Egypt because it was of the locality. They were in Israel. And Egypt is right next to Israel. And it was part of the Roman Empire. It'd kind of be like going from New York to Pennsylvania. It was basically just another state in the Roman Empire. If Denmark had been next to Israel, perhaps they would have went to Denmark. Your statement is idiotic right off the bat. Nowhere in the Bible does it say they went to Egypt to blend in. No, actually, it was to fulfill Scripture, because the Scripture says, out of Egypt I called my son. I mean, to make Jesus racial in any way, shape, or form is itself racist, Sean King. In this follow-up post, Sean King called for the destruction of stained glass windows and murals and all parts of Christian churches and buildings that depict biblical figures as white. And I'm running out of time. Yes, he wrote, tear them all down. They're nothing but tools of oppression and racist propaganda. We have here in Sean King a radical Marxist who is an apostate preacher who's moving in the spirit of Antichrist. But you know what it says in John, and I got to begin to wrap up because I'm running out of time. I hate when this happens because I got so much more I wanted to say. But John writes, little children, it is the last hour. And as you have heard this, that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us, i.e. Sean King. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might be made manifest that none of them were of us. I'm going to keep bringing it home. Where are the Peters, James, and Johns who will stand up to the authorities and say we ought to obey God rather than men? There are far too many pastors who refuse to talk about these issues from the pulpit because they're afraid of rocking the boat. They're afraid of upsetting their big tithers. But they'd be wrong. If you're a pastor that you're afraid to address these issues from the pulpit, you know, Barna Group did a survey years ago that overwhelmingly showed that congregations want to hear from their pastors regarding these cultural and social issues addressed from the pulpit. So pastors, if you've been hiding behind a false notion, thinking that people don't want to hear these issues addressed on the pulpit, they do. That being said, you need to be preparing the people the Lord has given you charge over for the things that are coming, pure and simple. You may think that you're safe and that these radicals aren't going to attack you, or that they're not coming after you or your local assembly because you're trying to stay out of the fray. You're trying to stay out of the controversy. But again, if you think that, you'd be wrong. They are coming for me and they're coming for you regardless. If you preach an uncompromising biblical message, they are coming after you because they are filled with a demonically inspired hatred and Antichrist spirit. Furthermore, whether you want to accept this or not, God is using all of these things, my friends. This is what's happening right now. Hear me. Trust me on this. God is using these things. God is using these persecutors to purge and purify his church, to separate the wheat from the chaff, to refine the remnant, because that is what the scripture says. It's not what Andy White says. It's what the scripture says. Daniel 11:32, but the people who know their God shall be strong. You were made to be courageous. The people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. And those are the people who understand shall instruct many. Yet for many days they shall fall by the sword, by the flame, by captivity and plundering. And some of those of understanding shall fall. Why? To refine them, to purify them, to make them white until the time of the end, because it is still for the appointed time. Yes, if you stand up and be courageous, if you stand up like a Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you might just get thrown into the fiery furnace. But we were made for such a time as this. Listen, pastors and ministers of God, I'm not trying to purposely offend you. I'm really not. But I am trying to shake you and wake you up from your apathy and from the complacency of appeasement. Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. Salt is good, but if it loses its flavor, how will you season it? Have salt in yourselves. Have peace with one another. Peace through strength. I believe there is a remnant of believers in America today, in the world today. There is a remnant of believers who are starving for a real salty and courageous leadership, my friends. America needs you. And the Church of God needs to rise up with a strong prophetic voice and declare that there is only one way to be saved. There is no other hope to be found outside of the gospel of salvation in Jesus Christ. But I'm out of time, folks, and I gotta run. God bless you. Watch. Stand fast in the faith. Be brave. Be strong. And let all that you do be done in love. I gotta go, folks. God bless. Thanks for joining in. Have a great week, everybody. Go to church on Sunday.